Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, thank you for coming. So we are going to talk about this chapter, Law of Large Numbers. But then you'll be shocked. Where's 6.2, 6.3, and 6.4? Don't worry about that. We'll talk about them, okay? Okay, so where are we now? We were actually talking about this, characteristic functions, if you remember. We talk about a related concept called the moment generating function, which is the Laplace transform of your probability density function. And then we say that now you talk about the Laplace transform, of course there's a thing called the Fourier transform of the density function. So last time we started to talk about a few examples of how do we use the characteristic function to do things. So as you are sitting down and calming down your emotion, let me turn on my computer, okay, to go to the website, and then let's download the table again. Okay, so where's the class website? So here's the class website. You can get this table. Okay, so now we are looking at this Fourier transform table. Let me talk about one example, maybe just to remind you what we are doing. Okay, so this is the characteristic function. This is the Fourier transform of your probability density function. Okay, and here's the table, the same table. And we talked about this example last time. So let's say you have a PDF being the exponential distribution function, then you can find the characteristic function as follows. Okay, basically go to the Fourier table and get the number. This is another example when you are given this a pair of random variables. You have their individual PDFs. I can take the Fourier transforms and then I can do the multiplication in the Fourier domain. I do the magic. In this case, Fourier transform of the previous distribution. Then as I am looking at the sum of these two random variables, then I can just multiply the two characteristic functions. Because convolution in the time domain equals to the multiplication in the frequency domain. So just remember the slogan. Then you can do the thing in the frequency domain. Oh, by the way, that's only true when you add two random variables. So this multiplication of two things in the characteristic function domain is only true when you add x and y. So if I give a problem of x times y, that's not true. Okay? If you work on x times y, then the way to solve that problem would be to go through the very ugly double integral. That's only true when you have x plus y. You can also do x minus y. When you have x minus y, then it will just be the expectation of e to the power minus j omega, and then it will be the expectation of e to the power plus j omega x. Okay, so that is okay, because the difference between two random variables is just the sum of two, but one will have a negative sign. Right? So the minus, we can do it. Multiplication and division, you cannot do this. So when you take the multiplication of these two random variables, then you can take the inverse Fourier transform, you can get this result. So that's also easy. Let's work on this problem. This is interesting. Example number three. So you have a sequence of random variables, they're all independent. The PDFs of these random variables are given by this formula. You have ak divided by pi times ak squared plus x squared. So this is a PDF for each k. And you have a sequence of these random variables. And then I'm going to form the infinite sum of these random variables. Okay, so this is hard enough. So you have x0, x1, x2, all the way to x infinity. Each one of those, they have their own PDF. All right, so you have many, many PDFs. you are going to consider this new random variable called y. Y equals to x0 plus x1 plus x2 plus dot dot dot. Okay? I want to find the PDF of y. Now, if you think this is too complicated, think about what we have been doing so far. If x0 is Gaussian, x1 is Gaussian, x2 is Gaussian, everyone is Gaussian, have the same mean, same variance, then, of course, all these f's will be the same. And then you're just adding a bunch of Gaussians. And we know that when you add Gaussians, it remains a Gaussian. You just add the mean, you just add the variance. So we sort of have seen something like that before. But in this context, they are not Gaussians. They are just some very interesting distributions, which we don't know what they are, but they have a form. We want to ask, how do we find the PDF of this new random variable? Then you are wondering, why do we need to encounter this kind of situation? As I mentioned multiple times, when you have multiple random variables, you may want to consider the sample average. The moment you want to consider the sample average, you're already doing this. So we want to find out the PDFs. Okay, so how do we solve this problem? Well, we're going to use characteristic function. So you have hk, right? So xk, where k can be 0, can be 1, can be 2. So let's just work on this xk. xk has a distribution of this ak divided by pi times ak squared plus x squared. So this is your PDF. And the hint is that we are going to use the Fourier transform table. So, who is the nearest neighbor in your table? 4. Okay, so I see some hands saying 4. Okay, so what does equation 4 says? Equation 4 says a squared divided by a squared plus t squared is going to be transformed as pi times a minus e minus a absolute of omega. Okay, so this is equation number 4. And clearly, equation number 4 doesn't really match with my formula here. Right? It doesn't match. But that's okay. We just need to make it match. So let's start with this formula. So ak squared divided by ak squared plus x squared. Okay, according to equation number 4, I know that it is going to give me pi times ak e minus ak times absolute of omega. Then I know, hey, that's just the duplicate of the equation number 4. But this is not what I want. I still need to do some interesting calculation. Like what? Well, here I have a pi in the denominator, so I just need to put a pi here. Then on the right-hand side, put a pi. Okay? Right, just match the term. Here you have a pi in the denominator, and you just put a pi here. And so on the right-hand side, put a pi. What else? I have ak in the numerator, but I have ak squared in the numerator. What should I do? Just remove an ak. Okay? So you do ak divide an ak, and so you have an ak here. Now I can do this because they are independent of my x. I can do the transformation, I can do the Fourier transform with all these constants. It doesn't really affect my result. So let's do this calculation here. So you have pi, you have ak cancel out, and so you will have this thing on the right hand side. And therefore, when you have this xk being a random variable, and this is the PDF, then when you take the Fourier transform, you're going to get e minus ak absolute of w. Any trouble of following me so far? It's really the table. It's OK? All right, silence means that either okay or not okay. Well, I assume that it is okay. Okay, so you have what? You have the Random variable, you have the PDF. The PDF has to take the Fourier transform to go to the characteristic function domain. And so you have found that fxk of x equals to ak divided by pi of ak squared plus x squared. And so the characteristic function of this thing is e minus ak times absolute of omega. Right, so this is fine. Okay, so what? Well, I need to find z equals to y equals to x0 plus x1 plus x2 plus dot dot dot. What it means is that I want to find the characteristic function of y. Now, what is the characteristic function of y? It will be the product of x0 times x1 times all the way to x, you have infinitely many of those. Just keep multiplying, okay? So now you have the formula for each of those. So it is just e to the power minus a0 times omega, e minus a1 times omega times a lot of those. So this is the characteristic function of your y. And then how do we solve this problem? When you have all these things multiplied together, it is just a big e to the power of a0 plus a1 plus a2 plus dot 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 times the absolute of w. So what are the a1 through a infinity? What are the a's? So then we need to go back to the problem. The problem says that your ak is 1 over 2 to the power k plus 1. So your ak is 1 over 2 to the power k plus 1. And so when you have a0 plus a1 plus a2 plus dot dot dot, that is equal to 1 over 2 plus 1 over 4 plus 1 over 8 plus dot dot dot, which is 1 half of 1 plus 1 over 2 plus 1 over 4 plus dot dot dot. And this is 1 over 1 minus 1 over 2. And so we have this number equals to 1. Okay, great. So you have all these numbers. You add them up, this will equal to 1. And so your characteristic function of your y, j omega, it is going to be e minus absolute of w. So what is the last step if I want to find fy of y? Just go to the table. Okay, which equation then? Nearest neighbor. 4. Okay, 4. Good. So 4 says that if you have equation 4 says that if you have pi a e minus a omega, you are going to get a squared divided by a squared plus. Now I've got to replace it by y because my random variable is y. It's no longer t. T is just a dummy variable on the table. So my variable is y, so I'll put a y here. So this is according to the table. But clearly here, what I have is just e minus omega. I don't have an a. So what I can do is that I'm going to look at this equation, e minus omega. How do I get from here to there? There are two things I need to do. One is about the a, one is about the pi. Let's talk about the a. Just make a equals to 1. I see the hand, okay? So make a equals to 1. So that means on this equation, you have 1 over 1 plus y squared. But I also have a pi, right? So I have a pi here. Now, if I don't want this pi, I just divide it by pi. Then I have 1 over pi here. So that means if I have E minus absolute of omega, I will get 1 over pi of 1 plus y squared. And this is my probability density function. So this is a phi of y. This is my fy of y. So you find that this yfy of y is this thing. 1 over pi times 1 plus y squared. So you solve the problem. So this problem, why is it interesting? It's interesting because with this tool here, you can handle infinitely many random variables. You can handle a sequence of random variables. They each have a different form. Okay? They follow the same family, but they each have a different parameter. Now, this example shows you that, well, if you look at this characteristic function and so on and so forth, you can eventually get to this infinite, the limit of this infinite sum, which can be very useful in some of the problems. Okay, so here is just the type up of the results that we have, and this is the result. So you can read the slides. why characteristic function but not the moment generating function? We have actually seen the distribution in this example. Okay, is this distribution. The moment generating function is undefined. As I said, the moment generating function is a Laplace transform, and therefore it covers the half space. Now, for the half space, you need to worry whether your distribution will diverge or not. Because you're taking a transformation, you're not guaranteed that the transformation will work. And so when you limit yourself to the characteristic function, the Fourier transform is only defined on the imaginary axis, so it's a lot easier to make it work. Okay? You can still make a Fourier transform not exist. Do you guys remember when will Fourier transform not exist? Oh God. There are conditions. Number one is that it has to be square integrable. So the function will take the magnitude square, you integrate from minus infinity to infinity. It has to be finite, so that's the first criteria. The second criteria is that you have finite number of oscillations because you're doing this cosine and sine representation. So you need to have a finite number of oscillations. The number three criteria is that you have finite number of discontinuities. Okay? So these are the three criteria for your Fourier transform to exist, according to Oppenheim and Wilsky. Okay, so go back to the textbook. So again here, for most of the distributions, the characteristic function exists, unless you really create something bizarre. For moment generating functions, I would say a good portion, they still exist, but if you work on some funny distributions like the Cauchy distribution, then you may not have it. It's very difficult to get oscillating PDFs, you know. And so Fourier transform in that sense is usually okay. So that sort of concludes this section. Any questions so far? Yes, please. Okay, good question. So let's look at this. Y equals to x1 plus x2 plus dot 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 plus xn. Okay, so I have a sum of random variables. And now let's look at the characteristic function of y, which is j omega y. Okay, j omega y. So now what is this? It is the expectation of E J omega of X1 plus X2 plus etc. to Xn. Okay? So the question is, here we have a sum. Why in the characteristic function domain it becomes a product? And here's the reason. When this is the definition of phi of Y, and it's equal to the expectation of the exponential something, and now you can see that it is the E to the power j x1 times e, e j x2, and so on. So e j omega xn. and therefore you have the product of all these individual characteristic functions. Now, you can write it in terms of the product, and there's a very important criteria that they are independent. If they're not independent, then your x1 and x2, they will have this covariance. Then you cannot break it into individual products. So the independence, they actually plays a pretty big role here. For most of the problems that we encounter in this course, they are independent. Unless I say that they have a joint distribution, then they will not be independent. Otherwise, mostly they're independent, and therefore you can factorize them in the expectation sense. Okay. Any other questions? Good. Now let's move on. Law of large numbers, 6.5. Where is 6.3 and 6.4? Okay, so 6.3 and 6.4, they are the tools. They are the mathematical tools to answer this question. 6.3 is about Jensen's inequality, which we do not need this in this class. You will need them later on in the other courses, so I decide to skip that. 6.4 is about Markov inequality and Chebyshev inequality. They will be needed to talk about 6.5. But if I start by telling you the inequalities, it will be super boring. It doesn't make sense to talk about inequality. Why the hell on this earth we need to learn about inequality? So it comes with a purpose. The purpose comes to here. Law of large numbers. Let me tell you the story first, and then I'm going to tell you the mathematical tool. Then we can talk about the conclusion. What is law of large number? Well, there are two things that by the end of 302 you really need to remember. Okay, besides all these beautiful PDFs and CDFs and all these messy calculus, there are really two principles. Okay, that are important. One is called the law of large numbers. The other one is called the central limit theorem. They're really important. The law of large numbers and central limit theorems, they are both talking about the same creature, is z equals to x1 plus x2 plus dot 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 plus xn divided by n. Okay? They're all talking about this thing here. Is a sum of n independent random variables. In our case, they are the RID. They're also identically distributed. So if one is Gaussian, the other one is the Gaussian. They have the same mean, same variance, but you have n of those. You have many of them. You want to form this thing, it's called a sample average. You want to look at the statistics of the sample average. Now, what I mean? So each individual random variable, they are random variables, they are random. Each of them, they have a PDF, they have their own mean, they have their own variance, they have their own CDF. Each random variable, each, okay? Because they're random variable, to talk about one random variable, you need to talk about their PDF. So each one of them, they have their own PDF. And then when you form this sample average, it is a random variable again. Okay, because it is composed of n random variables, and therefore z itself, it is a random variable. It has its own mean, its own variance, its own PDF, its own CDF. The question that we are asking here is, what would be the PDF of z? What would be the mean of z? Okay, what is the PDF and what is the mean of z? Law of large number says that when you have this z here, okay, when you have this z here, this z is very close to mu when n is large. Now, this is really, really vague, okay. First of all, what is mu? Well, mu, of course, it is expected value of any of these random variables. So I assume that they're RID, so I assume that they have the same distribution, they're Gaussians, they have the same mean. I just say that the mean is mu. Okay, so they have mu. And then when I form this Z, which is the finite sum divided by the total number of samples, this thing, it is approximately equal to mu. The question is, what do I mean by this approximately equal to? This is a random variable. It has a PDF. This is a deterministic number that doesn't have a PDF. Right? So this thing is not really defined. I need to talk about what I mean by this approximately equal to. But you can sort of get a feeling. When I form this sequence of random variables, I divide by n, well, the more I take, the more I will converge to some value. Now, if you ever wonder, you may think in this way. This z, okay, this z here, this z, it is a random variable. The random variable I can talk about is expectation, right? I can talk about the expectation. The expectation of z is expectation of x1 plus x2 plus dot 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 plus xn divided by n. The n can come out because it has nothing to do with my expectation. And then I have the expectation of the individual. And since they are independent, I will just have expectation of x1 plus expectation of x2 plus dot 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 plus expectation of xn, right? And then each of them is mu, this is mu, and so I have n of this mu, and divide by n, so I will get mu. Okay, so now if you're not following, you have mu plus mu plus mu plus dot 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 plus mu divided by n, and clearly this is mu. So at least, even though I haven't talked about this as approximately equal to, I know that if I take the expectation of z, it's going to give me the mu. Now, this law of large number is really about this a formal statement of this result. Z is approximately equal to a constant as n gets bigger and bigger. This is vague, okay? I need to define it more carefully. This is not a statement of the law of large number, but it sort of tells you the mean, okay? So that this random variable, when you look at the mean is going to converge. Okay, the mean, the sample average is going to converge to the population mean. So this is still a verbal statement of law of large number. Sample average converge to population mean. This is the verbal statement of the law of large number. And there's a weak law of large number, there's a strong law of large number, we don't have to worry about them. We are going to look at a weak law of large number because it's a lot easier to prove. So we're going to need to talk about that. But the weak law of large number talks about the sample average, which is this thing, is going to converge to the population mean as n goes to infinity. That's the mean. Very useful result because how many times do you need to access the full PDF? A little bit. But when you have a lot of random variables, you want to look at is mean behavior. This is what will be useful for the law of large number. Central limit theorem. Okay. Central limit theorem says that Z is approximately Gaussian. Regardless of what distribution you put in the first place. This approximately equal to, again, is vague, okay? Don't take it as the definition. It's vague, very, very vague, okay? We need to define it more precisely. Central limit theorem talks about not even the PDF, not even the CDF. It talks about the values on the CDF. I'll make this point clear later on, okay? But roughly speaking, if you do not need to go into probability theory for your career, if you do not need to do very, very difficult proof, then to me it is okay to think that Z is becoming Gaussian. I'm okay with that interpretation. Okay? But if you want to be very mathematically precise, then you need to talk about the value on the CDFs. It's really about the probability. So there are two different things. One only talks about the mean. The other one is talking about the distribution. If you think that the central limit theorem is a stronger result than this one, this is wrong. Because the central limit theorem, the sense of convergence is extremely, extremely loose. We will talk about that detail later on. The law of large number, if you talk about the strong law of large number, that's a very, very strong mathematical statement. Okay? So the convergence criteria is very strict. So these are two different results. Do not mess up. When we say that, okay, you have a lot of random variables that converge to something, to Gaussian, there's a central limit theorem. This also explains why a lot of ABCDEFG tests, they are coming from the Gaussian perspective because of this. When you talk about the convergence of the mean, this is the law of large number. So two concepts, they are different. Now, are you ready to talk about the first one? Let's look at something. Okay, so let's talk about this law of large number one by one, okay, very slowly. So what is law of large number? We need to start by talking about this thing called the sample average. So you have a sequence of random variables x1 through xn, and then you form this sum, you divide by n, you form this thing I call the xn bar. Now this notation is very carefully chosen. I have a subscript n to denote that I am using n random variables to construct my sample average. This capital N can be 100, can be 1,000, can be 10 million. There's a bar to denote that it is the average. So it is called a sample average of a random variable. Let me give you a pictorial illustration. That's the following. So, suppose I draw a Bernoulli random variable. Okay? So x is a Bernoulli random variable of probability 1/2. Very simple. Bernoulli random variable. And I have n of those. And n goes from 1, 2, 3, to big N. Okay, good. So what would be the number of states for xn? That's xn, Bernoulli, 1/2. How many states are there for xn? Two states, 0, 1. Okay, 0, 1, that's clear. So if I only take one sample, okay, xn, my result will be either 0 or 1. Okay, so this is x1. x1, you only have two states. Two state, right? And so this is also true for your x1 bar, because x1 bar is just the summation n going from 1 to 1 of xn. This is just x1. You only have two states. Okay, very simple. So now, let us plot this function here. This is n, okay? Number of samples I use to construct this sample. Now, when I am at one, what will happen to my random variable? Well, let's do this experiment. Today, I flip a coin. I get a 1. Tomorrow, I flip a coin. I get a 0. And then flip a coin again, I get a 1. Then I get a 0. You see? So these will be my state. Okay, so I'm mostly concentrated on these two. Now imagine that I have x2 bar. x2 bar is 1 over 2 of x1 plus x2. Okay, x1 plus x2, 1/2. So what would be the number of states? I can get 0, I can get 1, I can also get 1/2. I'm not going to get 2, I can get 1/2, because 0, 1 divided by 2. Okay, so if this is 1, this is 1 divided by 2, then you get 1. If this is 1, this is 0, you divide by 2, you get 1/2. So what will happen is that I'm going to get this, I'm going to get this, I'm going to get this. So this is when n equals to 2. These will be the state. that I can land on. And also think about that. Here I will have half chance being 0 or 1. And here, what would be the probability of getting the middle? It's higher because I can get 1, 0 or 0, 1. So I can actually have more crosses in the middle than the two sides. Okay? All right. So now let's do 3. X3 bar. This is 1 over 3. X1 plus X2 plus X3. So what do I have here? Well, you still get 1, you still get 0. You have 2 more states. Okay? You have more concentration here than the 2. When I go to 4, you get 5, right? And then clearly you have more here than there. See that? Okay? So now imagine that if I have 100, what will happen? No, you still have this. The chance of getting those will be small. You will have a bunch of crosses in the middle. Just draw it like this. Okay. And then you have something like this. See that? So you have a lot of mass that will be concentrated at the middle. You have a little thing that is staying here. As you go to 10 million, okay, imagine what will happen. Well, this thing will just be there, and then you almost have nothing over there, because it will just be concentrated. Most of these mass will be concentrated. Even in this case, you can see that, well, you have the chance of getting a 1, the chance of getting a 0, after this 100 coin flips, you need to make sure that all the 100 coin flips, they're all 0 in order to get to this 0 here, right? You need to get everyone to be 1 in order to get to this 1. So the chance of getting these two tails will be very, very small. And as you are increasing this number to 10 million, you are going to push this tail to even more towards the center. So there will be more concentration in the center. Okay, so where's the convergence? Well, the convergence says that I have this xn equals to 1 over n, x1 plus x2 plus dot 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 plus xn. Right? I'm looking at this random variable. This is a random variable. How would the distribution look like? Well, in the beginning, when n is 1, the distribution looked like 2 pulses. When I have 2, I have 3 pulses. When I have 4, 5, and I go to 100, you have 100 pulses. But, look at this. You're going to have more concentration in the middle. So as I'm going to 10 million, how will my distribution look like? How will my distribution look like? Is it going to be a Gaussian bimodal? How will it look like? Okay? How will it look like at this point? We have a name, yes? It becomes a delta function. Okay? It's all concentrated together, boom. Just at that point, becomes a delta function eventually as n goes to infinity. So start with a very, very wide distribution everywhere, but convergent to a delta function, right? Okay, so this is what we mean by approximately equal to, right? So this random variable is going to approximately equal to a delta function. Delta function, very powerful, okay? So this xn is going to become mean. Okay, what is this value? This is value, of course, is 1/2. Well, we know this is a fair coin, so it converges to 1/2. So this number converges to the mean. Okay? But then when you have taken math calculus, you know, when I draw this arrow, I mean that the limit of a sequence of numbers converging to another number. And if you're careful, you realize that, hey, on the left-hand side, this is a random variable. So I have the distributions, okay? On the right-hand side, I have a number. So it is really unclear how I can define a sequence of random variable converging to a number. So I need to clarify that. But I think you can see the picture here. By law of large number, I really mean that this sample average is converging to a scalar, which is the population mean. So now I need to talk about how do we define this notion of convergence? Okay, so sample average done. Okay, population mean, I think we discussed this mean, okay, which is just the expectation. We can also talk about the variance. We don't need it now, but you can see this picture here. You have a Bernoulli random variable, x1 to xn, probability 1/2. I can actually do this experiment. I did this experiment on Python and MATLAB, forget which one. But you can plot this diagram. In fact, you can do the same thing by yourself. You can draw these two curves, envelope, you can show that they are converging. Okay, so this is not cheating. Python code here. Okay, very beautiful Python code. You just run this for loop, loop through all the cases, then you can get this result. So I guess I will skip that. So let me talk about this thing here. It looks very complicated. So this is a statement of law of large number. Okay, so what do we have here? We have xn bar, okay? Xn bar. Xn bar is a random variable. How can I say anything about the convergence of a random variable as n goes to infinity? That's very difficult to say. However, I can look at an event. I can look at an event. So I know that it is going to converge to mu. Then I can construct this event bigger than some epsilon. Okay, this is an event. This event will be either yes or no, true or false. Whether my random variable is deviated from the mean for a magnitude bigger than some epsilon. Epsilon could be 0.01. It's a number I can choose. I'm just asking whether the statement is true or false. I call it an event. Okay? I call it an event, a binary event, and I give a name. The name is called bad. This is called a bad event. Why do I call it a bad event? Well, I'm measuring the event that my random variable, it has a state, it has multiple states. The state will be deviated from what it should be by a magnitude bigger than epsilon. It's called a bad event. And since this is an event, of course it is probabilistic. That means I can measure the probability of getting this bad event. So I can put the probability outside. So it is the probability of getting this random variable, it's called a sample mean, that deviates from the center for a magnitude bigger than epsilon. And since this is a bad event, if you want something to converge, do you want this probability to be big or small? Small. You want it to be small. You want the probability of having a bad event to be very small. Okay? You want it to be small. So, in fact, you want it to go to zero as n goes to infinity. Or in other words, I want the limit of n goes to infinity of this probability. Now, it looks complicated, but if you sit down one by one, okay, one step by one step, you sort of see the logic. Equals to zero. Okay? Bad event, the probability of bad event, the limit when n goes to infinity. Okay, why do I make it so complicated? Why can't I just say that xn converge to mu? The thing here is that this is not defined. You cannot have a random variable converging to a number. Because this one you have a distribution. This one is a scalar. You don't have a distribution. Here it is a well-defined real number sequence. Why? This is an event, but after I put the probability, it becomes a number. It becomes a number between 0 and 1. I can talk about this sequence of numbers, whether they're converging to 0 or not. This is well-defined. So, when I have this thing established, then I can say that, okay, if a sequence of random variable will satisfy this property, then I say that, okay, the weak law of large number holds. Okay, so that's the argument. Now, clearly, at this point, we have no tool to prove this result. What I want to show is that for a random variable that has a finite second moment, regardless of what distribution you have, as long as they have finite second moment, and you form the ID, and then you form this sample average, then for any epsilon bigger than zero, then this has to be equal to zero. Okay? So this limit has to converge. In other words, regardless of what distribution I have, as long as they have finite moments, then if I form the sample average, the sample average, this random variable has to approach to this scalar number, mu, as n goes to infinity. And the pictorial illustration is this. You first start with this pretty wide distribution, and then eventually you're converging. Now, what do I mean by this epsilon? So if I draw this x-axis being the center, which is the mu, and I draw the distributions of these, so they are just x1 bar, x2 bar, this is xm bar. So they are the PDFs of the sample means. If I set the epsilon to be here, the yellow region, then this bad event is asking what? This bad event is asking the probability of the tail. I'm asking about the probability of the tail. I want to make sure that the probability of the tail becomes smaller, smaller, smaller as n becomes bigger and bigger. So eventually what you can see is that as n goes to infinity, your distribution is going to become a delta function. Okay, so I'm asking about the tail probability. Okay, so now this thing, you feel like this is complicated, but in fact, this thing happens all the time. Here is an example. Let's say xn, they are Gaussians. They're Gaussians, okay? They're Gaussians. With a mean of mu with a variance sigma squared. Each of them is like this. And then you form the sample average. Let me show you what is the mean. So if you have x bar n, okay, let's talk about the expectation of this x bar n. The expectation of this x bar n just 1 over n, and then x1 plus x2 plus dot 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 plus xn. That will give you expectation of 1 over n of all the mu's. You add them up, and so that will give you mu. So the population mean is there. How about the variance? The variance is just the variance of 1 over n of x1 plus dot 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 plus xn. Now the variance, when you apply the variance to a constant, it becomes n squared. And then you have variance of x1 plus the variance of xn. They are independent, and so the cross terms, they disappear. What are the variance? Well, this is x sigma square, sigma square. So you have 1 over n square of sigma square plus dot 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 plus sigma square, and you have n of those. And so you have n sigma square here. So you will cancel out the n, so you get sigma square divided by n. Just for Gaussian, very simple. Okay, I can calculate that. And very quickly, we can see that the mean of the sample average is going to be the population mean. The variance of this Gaussian will have sigma divided by n. Therefore, if I start with a Gaussian, then as n becomes bigger, well, I should concentrate more. Yes, because my n is getting bigger, my variance becomes smaller, and therefore I have to converge, right? So this thing, if you put it down here in the, you can actually show with a little bit calculation. Okay, so you can calculate, what is the probability of this? Well, you can define this quantity as a delta alpha function of n, and then you have two tails. This is just CDF, a Gaussian, plug in the numbers. If you don't trust my formula, go to MATLAB Python, plug in your number. Just plug in different n's. Calculate this probability. You can call computers to calculate this probability. Specify the endpoints and calculate that. And now, this is computer experiment. Delta 1, delta 10, 1,000. So this is just all these different n's, right? Set n to be a bigger number. oh, they converge to zero very quickly. Right? So this the sequence of numbers, you're converging to zero very quickly, and therefore the limit holds. In fact, you can sit down and write down this standard Gaussian CDF, and you can show that it is converging to zero. All right? So when we come back, I'm going to show you some tools. It's called the Chebyshev inequality and also the Markov inequality that can help you actually answer this question more precisely. How do we prove this, the law of large numbers? All right? Okay, so I'll see you next time.